disease, whose guerrilla warfare against the Red Cross flag has hitherto outgeneraled even the greatest commanders, suffers a setback thanks to the new miracle drug, penicillin.
Penicillin was unveiled to the British public with understandable excitement. The story of its discovery seemed so strange and marvellous that it immediately became part of our national folklore.
This immense stride forward is due to a despised mold like the common growth on cheese.
Here at St. Mary's Hospital Medical School in Paddington, through this very window 25 years ago, a speck of mold blew in and settled onto Professor Fleming's culture plate.
The mold blowing in through the window is an attractive story. What really happened is even more bizarre. Romantic myths abound, but perhaps the greatest surrounds the discoverer himself. But if it had been left to Fleming, there would have been no drug today. Those who did the crucial work remain forgotten. It was Fleming who enjoyed the adulation of a grateful world. With incredible foresight, Fleming kept his original culture plate, and it's now a national treasure stored at the British Library. Unfortunately, it has badly decomposed, but a replica shows what caught Fleming's attention in 1928. In between a big blob of green mold and yellow clumps of bacteria lay ghosts of the dead microbes. Something emanating from the mold had killed them. Professor Gwynne McFarlane acknowledges this was a classic observation, but he also knows that Fleming failed to recognize the life-saving potential of this mold. On his retirement to Scotland, McFarlane decided to research the full story of the development of the drug and place Fleming's contribution in perspective.
Fleming has been widely accepted as a great man and a great scientist by many writers, popular and a few medical. On a par, as if Fleming was really on a par with Louis Pasteur or Galileo. Now, I really can't accept this.
He was nowhere near. He was about as third-rate as I am. He was a damn good technician. If he saw there was something walking in on one stick or something, he'd invent something to do with that stick.
Flem, as he was known, first became a bacteriologist in the same way he would discover penicillin, by accident.
Fleming had been a rather brilliant student, and when he qualified, he wanted to become a surgeon. But in the meantime, he was anxious to get a temporary job at St. Mary's, which would keep him in the rifle team, because he was a very good shot.
As a stopgap, he joined the inoculation department in 1906, and there he would remain for 49 years. He became absorbed in the study of bacteria. It was well known that these germs caused disease, but most supposed treatments were little better than quackery. Before antibiotics were available, many infections were lethal. They were feared as cancer and heart disease are today.
I'm old enough to remember hospital wards absolutely full of patients with septic infections, many of them young adults or children, and many of them who were in hospital for weeks at a time. Almost every organ in the body could become a seat of an infection. And really, there was almost nothing that the doctors could do about it. For example, I remember very well patients with pneumonia, which was a very common disease in those days, a very dangerous disease, often went on to a complication which pus formed in the chest. And then a part of a rib would be removed and a tube would be put in, and the patient would sit in bed, perhaps for 5 or 6 weeks, with pus draining out of this wound, down a tube into a large jar under the bed, which might easily contain a pint or two of pus. And this went on for weeks.
Ironically, while pneumonia and TB remained incurable, an effective treatment was found for the scourge of high society, syphilis. After 605 fruitless attempts, the German chemist Ehrlich made an arsenic preparation nicknamed 606, which could cure the pox. He sent some to his old friend Almroth Wright, the godfather of British microbiology and Fleming's awesome boss. Scornful of any chemical treatment, he passed 606 on to Fleming.
Fleming was extremely neat and dexterous with his hands and could be guaranteed to give intravenous injections without the material spilling out into the tissues, which could be dangerous. And as he devised an improvement in the method of diagnosing syphilis, he soon had quite a wide practice in the West End of London.
His success earned him the nickname Private 606. It should have alerted him to the idea of treating other infections by injecting chemicals into the bloodstream, but it didn't. Under the powerful influence of Almroth Wright, his scepticism grew, particularly after their experience in the First World War. Fleming accompanied him to the Casino Hospital in Boulogne, where they began a study of war wounds.
Most battle casualties were infected when they arrived in the hospital. The most common infection was with streptococci and staphylococci, but a less common but very dreaded one was infection by the organism gas gangrene. This produced a spreading gangrene of muscle which moved with terrifying rapidity, and unless a surgeon could amputate above this infection, the result was invariably fatal. Most army surgeons relied on local chemical antiseptics to control the septic infections. But Wright and Fleming soon found that these antiseptics actually did more harm than good.
They destroyed the victim's natural healing power by killing the body's white blood cells more easily than they killed the invading bacteria. This was why Fleming had grave doubts about using chemicals. The experience in Boulogne might have led to a systematic search for new agents which could fight bacteria without causing damage. But Fleming was not that sort of scientist, as Ronald Hare, a junior researcher at St. Mary's, remembers.
What he did like to do was the odd, which nobody else had ever done. He was the first, for example, to use the cellophane that cigarette packets are wrapped in. He grew microbes on those. Just like anything. Nobody had ever thought of using it. And he used to give presents of it to people who came to see him and that sort of... He delighted in that sort of thing. But when it came to high-class theory and all the other things that make textbooks, he couldn't be bothered with it at all.
People collect stamps or plants or observations of birds. Fleming did this with bacteria. An example of this, he collected an extraordinary sort of bank of strange bacteria which produced different colored pigments. And he used to construct pictures, colored pictures, painted on a culture medium with brushes loaded with these bacteria. And as they developed and grew, they formed the most beautiful little pictures.
Fleming's germ games occasionally paid off. Experiments on the fluids of his nose and eyes led to his first important discovery. Using a squirt of lemon juice, he collected his own tears. It seemed they contained some ingredient which killed off bacteria in minutes. He needed more tears, so recruiting young lab technicians at threepence a squirt, he had them queuing up to undergo the ordeal by lemon. Punch called it tear antiseptic. Almroth Wright christened the new discovery lysozyme. However, this natural germ-killing substance did not kill disease-causing bacteria. It had no practical value, but it did prepare Fleming for his second accidental discovery, penicillin.
One day, in the year 1928, he was examining some sepsis germs grown on jelly before sending them to be destroyed. He noticed that one of the dishes had gone moldy and that round the patch of green mold, the sepsis germs were dying. Some powerful natural antiseptic was obviously exuded from the mold.
It was a daily event for Fleming to leave his laboratory down the stairs and come upstairs about 11 o'clock to get a cup of coffee. On this occasion, he had a culture plate in his hand and proceeded to show it to all of us. And I think it would be correct to say that nobody took the slightest notice of Fleming's discovery for a very long while.
Good evening, Sir Alexander. It isn't often that we have the privilege of meeting somebody who's made such an important discovery as you've made.
2 months before he died, he was interviewed by Dr. Charles Fletcher. It's not hard to see why he failed to excite fellow scientists at the time of his discovery.
Well, I got contaminations, and when I looked at them a week afterwards, all sorts of contaminations, but one of them was a mold.
Now, by contamination with a mold, do you mean the sort of thing that happens to a housewife if she leaves the top off her jam too long, that sort of thing? That's
exactly the same. Exactly the same. Here's a good example provided by the BBC. Here is a pot of jam, and on the surface here, on top of the paper, there are a number of molds. Maybe the same mold that I got, maybe not, I don't know.
In fact, very few molds produce penicillin. It turned out to be a particularly rare strain. The discovery is not as simple as it first appears. Fleming always went along with the story that it was just any old mold blowing in through the window. But his window was almost impossible to open because of all the junk on the sill. It's far more likely that tiny mold spores drifted up the staircase from the floor below, where exotic strains were being collected by a man studying allergies. Even so, it has proved extremely difficult to reproduce the effect Fleming observed because molds and microbes grow at different temperatures. Fleming's experiments usually involved sowing bacteria on plates and putting them in an incubator to encourage growth. Professor Hare believes that on this occasion, some plates were left out in the cold on the bench, and one became contaminated with mold. Fleming left to go on holiday, and the weather did the rest. First, a cold spell allowed the mold to flourish. Then the temperature went up, and the bacteria started growing. Beneath the lid of an abandoned laboratory plate, the mold started killing off the young bacteria. An oblivious Fleming returned from holiday 3 weeks later. He started going through his old plates and, finding nothing of interest, dumped them in a tray of disinfectant, ready for washing up. Luckily, the important plate was left high and dry above the liquid, only inches away from destruction. It's typical of Fleming that he happened to rummage through the plates again to show an old friend what he'd been up to. There, among his dirty dishes, was the extraordinary plate.
The things which had to happen in order to make Fleming's discovery possible form an almost incredibly improbable series of chance events. I think this really illustrates the part that luck plays in many scientific discoveries, but this discovery of penicillin by Fleming must be a supreme example of this.
Having had this lucky break, astonishingly, Fleming abandoned his new discovery. But why? Macfarlane has followed up clues originally unearthed by Hare in the rare manuscripts room of the British Library.
Now, the reason why Fleming lost interest in penicillin so early, in a matter of a few months, in fact, lie in this notebook, which are his original records of experiments. It would be very nice to show you these experiments, but unfortunately Lady Fleming has refused her permission, and thereby part of the Fleming myth will undoubtedly be preserved. Briefly, this book shows that he did most of his penicillin experiments in glass containers, and from these experiments he concluded that penicillin would very rapidly be destroyed in living tissues. Now, living tissues and glass are two quite different systems, and in fact Fleming was wrong in his conclusion.
What Fleming failed to realize was that his neat experiments in glass did not accurately mimic what happens inside a living human being. His results convinced him that when penicillin was mixed with blood, it lost most of its germ-killing power. So he never did the obvious experiment of trying penicillin on an animal injected with a fatal dose of bacteria. He never thought of it as a general antibiotic. Instead, he concentrated on its ability to kill some bacteria, but not others. He saw it as a useful laboratory tool for identifying different microbes. Fleming did publish a paper, but it was a rather vague description of a laboratory curiosity, hardly something to attract much notice. He soon moved on to other things. For 10 years, penicillin was relegated to obscurity. The story of its re-emergence in Oxford has its own share of lucky coincidences, but it depended on a totally different approach to science and the determination of an ambitious researcher who had earned the best chair of pathology at the age of 37, Howard Florey. Florey grew up in Adelaide.
I remember my father consulting the headmaster, and he said, "Oh no, you can't go in for chemistry, there's no outlet in Australia." And it was then that my thoughts turned to medicine.
As a ship's doctor, he worked his passage to England in 1921. He'd won a highly prized Rhodes Scholarship to Oxford.
One could get away with any sort of gaucheries as bar, just one of these rough colonials.
Florey was a rough, tough Australian, completely uncompromising, rather prickly, very energetic and tense as a coiled spring. And he brought to his work this extraordinary dedication, which was very infectious in such a way that he really could collect a team of people who became almost as dedicated and enthusiastic as himself.
I had a refugee German chemist named Chain, whom I got from Cambridge.
Chain was a brilliant biochemist, and I think he knew it. He was extremely excitable, and he used to pace up and down a room while he was talking and hiss loudly before making some extremely enthusiastic remark.
There's no blueprint to discovery, you see. I mean, this is an individual, it's an art, really. I mean, you can't lay this down. But the general principle is that you go out and you look for interesting biological, odd, interesting new biological phenomena which you hope you will be able to explain in chemical terms.
He proposed, and I agreed to go along with it, that we made a thorough investigation of antibacterial substances.
Chain searched through over 200 scientific papers. Eventually, he chanced upon one in a 10-year-old journal. Another stroke of luck. They already had a sample of Fleming's mould in their culture store. Growing it in small flasks was easy. The difficult part was getting the active ingredient out of the liquid which the mould produced.
The chemical properties of the substance were most unpromising. It was described as so unstable that you lost it practically while you looked at it.
Not only was it notoriously elusive, but just one part in 2 million was penicillin. To separate it from the vast amounts of impurity, they used solvents. But when they evaporated the solvent, they lost most of the penicillin too. The breakthrough came when Dr. Norman Heatley suggested the ingenious chemical trick of transferring the penicillin back into water by changing the acidity. Chain was against the idea. He was often a difficult man to argue with.
For example, he said in one of the early days, penicillin was yellow. And I said, well, it could be, but you have no evidence for this. And his reply was, but Heatley, I am telling you it is yellow. Yellow, yellow.
Even after Heatley's process, it still contained masses of impurities. Pure penicillin is in fact white.
All gatherings for purposes of entertainment and amusement, whether outdoor or indoor, which involve large numbers congregating together, are prohibited until further notice. Air raid warning.
Florey made his own film of the lab's preparations for war.
Take shelter.
It was an inauspicious time to be attempting research.
Will be sounded in some places.
Lack of funds, equipment shortages, and the risk of air raids were a constant threat.
Warbling note, changing every.
Yet he was diverting more and more of his department's effort to penicillin.
until you hear the raiders past signal.
But in this inferno, while the BEF and their French comrades held off the Nazis in an epic rearguard action, the smoke...
On May the 25th, 1940, that was a day I'll never forget. We did an absolutely crucial experiment to see whether penicillin would prevent the certain death of mice which had been experimentally infected with a deadly streptococcus, a kind of disease germ. 8 mice were taken, and all were given a certainly fatal dose of this organism. Then 4 of them were given penicillin.
At the time, Heatley kept a diary.
After supper with some friends, I returned to the lab and met the professor to give a final dose of penicillin to 2 of the mice. The controls, the ones who hadn't had penicillin, were looking very sick, but the treated mice seemed very well.
He began his Saturday night vigil. The future of penicillin rested on the fate of the mice.
I stayed at the lab till 3:45, by which time all 4 control animals were dead. It really looks as if penicillin may be of practical importance. I left the labs at 3:45 a.m. on Sunday, this was, when it was already beginning to grow light, and was challenged by a man with a rifle.
And after, though the shape of the world may alter, in our tunes the laughter blends the tears.
Went to the lab at 11:45 and found all 4 treated mice alive and well.
Florey was ecstatic. He immediately phoned Dr. Margaret Jennings, who would later become his second wife.
When the professor rang me up on that Sunday morning, he expressed his feelings about the result of this experiment by saying, "It looks like a miracle." And as he was usually a person who was given to understatement, this was very surprising. The expression he used meant that he was really excited about it.
Florey was, even at that time, looking far ahead because he was thinking that this would have to be tested in man, and he pointed out that a man is 3,000 times the size of a mouse.
This meant really scaling up an already very difficult process to a point at which a university department really had to be turned into a factory. This had to be Florey's decision, and it was really a very bold one, because this, after all, was a university department, and there was an obligation to teach students and all the rest of it. And to change its character really so dramatically and extensively might have led Florey into quite considerable trouble if the venture had not come off.
In vessels of all sizes and descriptions, 1/3 of a million men, including the wounded, were embarked and brought home under the protection of the Royal Navy.
With the evacuation of Dunkirk underway, Florey was beginning to realize penicillin could have an important effect on the outcome of the war.
There was a risk, of course, that the Germans might, as Professor Florey said, come roving down Headington Hill in the Panzers. And so some of us took a bit of the fungus and smeared it in the linings of our coats in order to get a few million spores there. And then if anyone had escaped, if the Germans had come and someone had escaped, one could have started up the culture again.
Making enough penicillin to treat patients was very difficult. The first problem was what to grow the mold in.
What was needed was a layer of medium not more than 1/2 inch thick in a vessel which could be steam sterilized. We used all the laboratory flasks and bottles and containers that could be used, but they weren't, of course, enough. And we found that you could grow the stuff in tins, curiously enough, and these are some of the equipment we used. But the best container was the hospital bedpan. The Radcliffe Infirmary let us have 16, which was all they had.
Eventually, Heatley found a firm in the Potteries who agreed to produce an abstract form of bedpan to his specification. He drove up to collect them, and on Christmas Day 1940, he seeded them with penicillin mold. Then, to help the volunteers harvest the gallons of liquid, he invented a natty gadget.
These containers were put on these trolleys, which could be tilted so that the liquid came down to the level of the spout. We got the liquid out through this pistol. This is a sterile tube through which the liquid can be removed, and at the same time, sterile air is blown into the container to take its place. The target of this process was 500 litres a week, and we never reached this, but we did in fact get enough for the clinical trials.
By January 1941, they were ready. Dr. Charles Fletcher joined the team. As a junior doctor at the Radcliffe Infirmary in Oxford, he had to find a suitable patient.
There was a policeman who'd been in what was called the septic ward, a terrible sort of ward where we don't have now, with people with abscesses and bores and blains all over them. And this policeman was particularly badly ill. He'd had a sore in his mouth about a month previously. The infection had spread over his scalp. He had abscesses there. It had spread to both his eyes, one of which had had to be removed. He had abscesses that had been cut open on his arm. He had abscesses in his lung. He was well on his way towards death from this terrible infection. And we had nothing to lose and everything to gain, so we thought we'd have a try. The shortage of penicillin was such that after the first day, I collected all his urine, his urine had been saved, and I took it in a bottle over to the Dunn laboratory where Florian was working, so that the penicillin could be extracted from the urine and used again on the third day. And when I got over there, it was absolutely delightful, because Flory was a very taciturn man, a very man of few words, and he would say, well, how's the patient? He was an Australian, with a bit of an Australian accent. And then Chain, who was an Eastern European, was excitable and say, what's the patient like? Is he doing well? Oh, that's marvelous, isn't it? And this lovely contrast in these two characters in charge of the work. And every day I did that. On the third day, he was having the same penicillin as he had on the first day. And on the fourth day, he really was dramatically improved. And he was sitting up in bed and his temperature had come down. On the fifth day, the penicillin began to run out and we couldn't go on. Because, of course, when they extracted from the urine, they didn't get it all back and there just wasn't enough to go on. And he wasn't cured. He gradually relapsed and then went on and eventually died.
It would be almost a year before a large clinical trial would support their conviction that penicillin worked. They had successfully treated four other patients, including a baby, but once again, supplies were exhausted. But the trial had been fraught with risk, as Dr. Abraham knew very well.
It has to be remembered that the penicillin used in the clinical trials was no more than, in most cases, about 4% pure. And it really was very fortunate indeed that among this mass of impurity, that there was no substance that was highly toxic.
Flory needed outside help to grow and purify penicillin. He was impatient. The British drug companies were preoccupied with the war effort and offered little support. So, with Heatley in tow, he left Britain. En route to America, Flory filmed the delights of wartime Lisbon.
There was no blackout. One saw people having, you know, 5 or 6 spoonfuls of sugar in their coffee and music and so on.
Flory had left behind a disgruntled Chain.
Chain was, in fact, furious when he found that this was happening. But there was a very good reason for Heatley going, because he was the person who had the clearest experience of the production of penicillin in the laboratory.
On July the 1st, 1941, they boarded the Clipper for New York.
The Clipper was amazing. About 5 compartments, each as big as my room at Oxford, with luxurious seats, lovely carpets and upholstery.
Their precious samples of mold, having crossed the Atlantic in the Clipper fridge, would now have to brave 90 degrees in New York. Dr. Heatley returned to retrace the journey which was to alter the course of penicillin development. With lightweight suits in hand, Heatley and Florey were ready to take on America. Their mission, to spread the gospel of penicillin. Florey was in his element.
I think he was a very good salesman. All he wanted to do was to persuade somebody to make him about a kilogram of the kind of stuff we were using in Oxford and making in Oxford. He wasn't concerned at all whether this or that firm were going to make it on a big scale. That was entirely out of his range.
But scaling up was what interested the drug companies. With little to go on apart from an unpublished account of their clinical trial, they would need to do some fast talking.
We were shunted first of all to Dr. Tom, who was the sort of eminent father of microbiology.
Intrigued by the unusual properties of this penicillin mold, Tom whisked them over to his gigantic headquarters at the U.S. Department of Agriculture. Immediately, cables were exchanged with a remote lab in the Midwest. Within days, they were traveling through the heart of the Corn Belt. The end of the line was Peoria, Illinois. When they arrived in 1941, they were met by Dr. Robert Coghill, who took them back to his lab. It had been originally set up after the Depression to find ways of using agricultural waste products. They knew a lot about growing microbes, molds, and other fungi using techniques similar to brewing. Producing penicillin was just such a fermentation process. It posed an interesting challenge for Coghill.
We started work on it the next day. That's how important we felt it was. We pulled Dr. Moyer off the work he was doing at the moment and put him on the penicillin project.
Moyer's great skill was feeding fungi, and he was soon checking what Heatley used to grow penicillin.
At Oxford, we had had brewer's yeast extract, boiled extract, and when Moyer learned of this, because I was telling him everything that we knew, of course, he said, I'm not too enthused about yeast extract. We haven't got any. But we'll try some corn steep liquor.
Corn steep is a byproduct of turning corn into starch. After the niblets have been stripped from the cob, they're soaked or steeped in huge vats until the outer husks are softened. The liquors produced are rich in nutrients and so form an ideal medium for growing fungi. When it matures, it becomes dark and treacly.
We have lots of this corn steep liquor around the laboratory, and so it was natural that Dr. Moyer would use it in his early experiments.
At first, nothing did grow, and I remember Moyer saying, I kind of figure we're going to be doing some plain and fancy cussing around here.
After a couple of weeks of Moyer's cussing, their persistence paid off.
Well, a lot of good work came out of this lab, and this was Dr. Moyer's office.
Yes.
Remember how he used to hide his notes when we walked in unexpectedly like
yes,
this?
Yes, I do.
Cover them up so we couldn't see what he was doing.
It took a man of great tact and diplomacy to cope with the difficult, secretive Moyer.
Moyer was known to be strongly anti-British, and he certainly was. We got on quite well, but there was the business of him not telling me what he was doing. I'd been away on a trip, and when I came back, I said, how are you getting on? What yields are you getting? And he said, oh, we're sometimes up to 20 units per mil. And I said, well, how'd you do that? That's splendid. And he said, oh, well, I did some
some chemicals, and from that time on, I never knew what he was doing.
Much later, Moya published a paper in his name alone. It meant he could take out foreign patents on the cornsteep medium without consulting Heatley. This would cause much resentment in Britain. While Heatley and Coghill persevered with Moya, Florey decided to move on to continue his odyssey. The quest for his kilo of penicillin would take him to any scientist who might have a string to pull and could get the drug companies interested. Florey said he sometimes felt like a carpetbagger, but one man would make it all worthwhile. Richards got things moving. As chairman of the government's Committee on Medical Research, he wrote to four leading drug companies informing them government funds might be available for penicillin research.
Richards was a remarkable person, and he selected the companies with great care. I don't think anyone realized the time that Richards began, what an enormously big project he was undertaking. But he was the right man for the job at the right time.
The drug companies were pessimistic. They were not galvanized by reports of Oxford's amateur production.
The Pearl Harbor is now being attacked. This is an emergency communique from the Hawaiian Defense Headquarters. The roar of the planes you now hear is not a practice maneuver.
December the 7th, 1941. From now on, penicillin production would become a matter of the greatest national importance. Richards called the heads of the Big Four to an urgent meeting in New York. Coghill, up from Peoria, would be his trump card.
Dr. Richards called on me, and I reported Moyer's work in raising the yield of penicillin by 30-fold. That was a great surprise to the industrial people, and George Merck immediately got to his feet and said, if those results can be repeated, we'll get the kilo of penicillin for Florey.
The other companies soon followed Merck's lead. The goal was not 1 kilo, but thousands of kilos for the American troops. Yet patriotism now vied with commercial advantage. Would the drug companies pool their information, or would the veneer of mutual cooperation wear thin? Dr. Gladys Hobby later worked for the biggest wartime producer, Pfizer.
It was really almost contrary to their instincts to release information as freely as was being requested by the government. And yet they knew that it was important to do so, and they did make the attempt to do so. Pfizer, in particular, had always been a fermentation firm. Their products were all made by fermentation, and therefore they had certain technology that other companies did not have. And they obviously didn't wish to release all their information.
Norman Heatley was now with Merck, watching their yields go up. He was sworn to secrecy about their progress. Meanwhile, Florey was back in Oxford, wondering what had happened to his kilo.
Florey did get a parcel from Merck's, quite a big one, and he unwrapped it, and inside was another box, and that was unwrapped with mounting excitement. And inside that was a third box, and inside that was this tiny sample of penicillin. I wasn't there, but I think I can imagine some of Florey's remarks.
When Florey got back from America, he found that things had not been going very well with the production. There had been a good deal of trouble with contamination during the time that Chain looked after this aspect of the work.
At Oxford, they were having to get by with a pilot plant composed of dairy machinery and discarded junk. It produced just enough to start a new clinical trial, but Florey felt cheated by the Americans and despaired of most British drug firms. To add to his troubles, Fleming was being given all the credit. A letter to the Times from Almroth Wright had started it. Fleming had asked Florey for some penicillin to treat a dying friend. The dramatic cure made excellent news. While Fleming gave dozens of interviews, Florey shunned the press.
The newspaper campaign was, in fact, kept going by really quite powerful forces. There was St. Mary's Hospital, of course, who relied on voluntary contributions. The second thing was that Almroth Wright, who was an influential man, wanted credit for his department. And Beaverbrook, who was a very powerful patron of the medical school and St. Mary's Hospital and very generous donor, stated quite categorically that he felt it his duty to see that the credit did go to Fleming. And finally, the Ministry of Information undoubtedly wanted publicity for good news.
By 1943, several British companies were finally attempting to mass-produce penicillin.
It may need the product of 100 flasks to cure a single wounded man. Present output only meets the priority calls from the fighting fronts.
In May 43, Florey travelled to North Africa with just enough penicillin to give the drug its most demanding test, the treatment of war wounds. His radical suggestions would transform the management of battle casualties. He took his camera to record the work. This case is the smallest wound he filmed. Rather than leave a wound open, the normal practice, he suggested it should be cleaned and sewn up. Penicillin was then immediately injected through tubes every few hours to prevent infection. There was no doubt it worked. This man would almost certainly have lost his leg had it not been for penicillin.
The military commanders in the field had been most impressed by the fact that one or two injections of penicillin cured cases of gonorrhea like magic. Now, thousands of their troops were, in fact, hors de combat with gonorrhea, and they were due to take part in the invasion of Sicily. They therefore appealed to General Poole, the director of pathology, for penicillin to be used for restoring these men to their units. Poole put this to Florey and Cairns, who was with him, and they felt that this was really quite unacceptable, that penicillin should be used for scallywags with self-inflicted wounds rather than genuine battle casualties. So Poole referred the matter to Churchill, and Churchill sent back a note saying, "This valuable drug must on no account be wasted. It must be used to the best military advantage." Now, General Poole interpreted this to mean that the best military advantage was to use penicillin for restoring the gonorrhea incapacitated patients to their units.
In America, highly automated bottle plants were now operating. Even so, it was an inefficient process, falling far short of demand. They really needed to grow penicillin in large tanks in the same way beer is fermented. But persuading the mold to grow in the body of the liquid rather than the surface was proving difficult. A new strain of mold was required.
At one point, the War Production Board said that a new culture producing more penicillin would be worth $1 million.
Peoria would once again make the breakthrough. Professor Raper had been searching for a new strain to replace the original Fleming mold since the summer of 41. He enlisted the help of Army Transport Command. Soil samples were flown in from all over the world. The molds they contained were analyzed. The most promising came from Cape Town, Chongqing, and Bombay. But the search for an even better strain continued.
we were plating them out and isolating blue-green molds, checking them to see if they belonged to the group that Penicillium notatum, Chrysogenum belonged to, and then screening them for penicillin production. We employed a girl to make the rounds of different shops and stores and bring in moldy materials. Well, it was in that way that we came across a mold on a cantaloupe.
They had searched the whole world, but the best strain was found on a moldy melon in a local Peoria market. This mold thrived in deep culture vessels. Clever laboratory manipulations increased yield still further. By D-Day, there would be enough penicillin to treat all Allied casualties.
What has impressed me most, contemplating the story of the development of penicillin, is how one needs complementary characters. Fleming was a brilliant observer, but really without the either the character or the drive to work out and work through the results. As regards the Fleming myth, I think I feel a bit despondent about our ability to change it in any way. Today, far more people have heard of Fleming than have ever heard of Flory, and I think this will probably continue.
Redus, doctoris in medicina honoris causa, conferendus in Norman George Heatley.